who hunger and thirst for justice, they will be satisfied. Bless us, O Lord, hear our cry for justice. Bless us, O Lord, our God. We are the light of the world. May our light shine before all, that they may see the good that we do and give glory to God.
Good morning. Good to see you all today, and welcome, a special welcome to those of you who are visitors and guests. We are very thankful to have you with us, and I'm hearing myself like hum, so that's odd for me, but although I do hear other things often, so.
There you go, guys, thank you. And so we just want to say welcome and be sure that you feel at home here at Peace. And if there's some way that we can tell you about the ministry, what God is doing here, we'd love that opportunity. So just make yourselves known, and we can do that. On the back of the seats, there's a number of things there, but one of them is a Connect card. And if you want to fill that out and just leave us some information, we'll follow up with you in the week afterwards and just get to talk to you or connect with you somehow. In addition to that, we have a couple announcements today. One is that today is our annual meeting, and in my years of being a pastor, I've been at a lot of annual meetings. And I have to tell you that the annual meetings at Peace Lutheran Church are the best. They go move right along. Everyone gets a chance to hear what's going on. Our budget issues are... we have wonderful gifts and your generosity, and so we just want to say thank you. And so I encourage you, please, get something to drink, a little treat, and then come back into the sanctuary and stay for the annual meeting. We'd love to have you hear about what a great year 2022 was and how excited we are about the year ahead as well. A couple other things to mention coming up here. We have a craft day. Yes. If you look at your bulletin, you will see that listed right there. And you can sign up for that at a table out by the Coke Room. It's called Love Deeply Craft Weekend, and on Friday and Saturday. And it's a lot of fun. There are a number of people from our church who have various skills and different crafts that will be here to share those, and you can be a part of it. You can bring your own and be a part of it as well. And there's a lunch and just great fellowship together. So if you're interested in that, stop out at the table and talk to Jamie. She'd love to talk to you about it. A couple other things that are coming up in February here. If you haven't heard about this yet, this is the third annual chili cook-off here at Peace Lutheran Church. And people make their favorite recipe of chili. And then we have our volunteer firefighters who are our judges. And they will award the coveted wooden spoon trophy. And so that's what you get. There's no prize money involved or anything like that. But there is the honor and glory of being the winner and the wooden spoon. Please sign up your chili. And it can be any kind of chili that you would like to. We're working on a Norwegian chili that will have the protein will be lutefisk, and just
more for you.
Might be unusual. And the spice is salt.
Take
it up. So please sign up for that. You can do so at the table out with the clipboard, or you can go online and do that as well. It'll be a fun morning here on the 12th. It's also New Member Sunday, and so if you're interested in being a member here at Peace Lutheran, I'd love a chance to talk to you. You can fill out that card again on the back of the deal, or just see me afterwards, and we can discuss what that means and how to be a part of it. I think there's two families already signed up for that, so please let us know. We'd love to have you become part of the Peace family. And then it's also Jersey Sunday because somebody said it's Super Bowl, but you can't say Super Bowl because it's a trademark name. And so Super Bowl will be that Sunday. And we're going to all wear our favorite team jerseys. And so probably be a lot of Packers and Vikings and people like that, or just the local high school team. That'd be great. Okay. One last one. Oh, be sure to sign up if you haven't for the Valentine's Spaghetti Dinner. Buy your tickets and get started on that. That is a great event, a lot of fun, and it all goes to support the mission trip that will be this summer for our youth. So, wonderful time, great evening together. Well, that's all the announcements, I think, unless I'm missing one. Anybody? Yes, hold it.
Do you want me to come up there, Pastor?
Yeah, why don't you come on up here? We'll turn on this.
I'm so sorry. Good morning. I don't know if this is on, but Mark Nissen is, he got stranded last night at the airport. He was supposed to be here today, but is not. So he had asked me to make an announcement. Tomorrow night at 6 p.m., we are having kind of like a fundraiser, a fundraiser meeting about the mission trip, okay? So we have a mission trip coming up in June. We are looking for anybody that would be interested in just kind of throwing out some ideas, getting some things together. If you love planning, if you love cooking, if you love crafting, if you love anything to do with anything, we can probably use your help, okay? So we're just always looking for ways to earn money, fundraise for the kids for the mission trip. So it will be here tomorrow at 6 p.m. If you don't have kids, it doesn't matter. We'd love to have anybody who would want to help be a part of raising money for our mission trip. We do have our Valentine's dinner coming up. We did one last year here. The date I'm not going to give out quite yet, but it will be after Valentine's. But like that would be one thing that we would be looking for people that would want to help set up, clean up, cook, do activities, put tables together, anything like that. So any help would be much appreciated tomorrow at 6 o'clock here at Peace. Thank you.
Wow, that's great. It says February 26th.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
I didn't know if it was printed yet.
And are you getting the same meatballs that you had with this
meeting? We will try.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
I bet we will. They're super good.
So, well, thank you for that. And let's begin our worship by joining together in singing. I encourage you to reach out to those beside you and hold the hand of a brother or sister in the Lord across the aisle if you can make it stretch there. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this day. It comes to us as a gift given.
We thank you, Lord, for the promise of your love that comes through your Son, Jesus, that we might know that love and grow in it. Bless us this day. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Share the peace. If you would, and then let's join together in the confession and forgiveness. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open and all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. For those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become children of God and bestows upon them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Invite you to be seated. Invite the children to come up for jam.
Good morning, boys and girls. Is everybody warm enough this morning? Oh my goodness, it's cold out. Guess what? Next week it's supposed to be really warm again. I'm so excited. Maybe some of the snow will melt too. So this morning we're going to talk about something that Jesus did that when you get older you probably will recognize it more so, where he talked about going, in the scriptures it says he went to pray or talk to his disciples, and it's called the Sermon on the Mount. And a lot of people maybe don't even know what that's about. They've heard it, but they don't know what it means. And what did he talk about? Have any of you heard that, where he went and did the Sermon on the Mount? It's pretty popular. No? Any of the adults? Got a couple. those of you that maybe looked ahead in the schedule and knew what we were talking about today would know. But it's about the Beatitudes. And there's actually 9 of them. So Jesus went up to the mountain, and he went and talked to his disciples. And he gave them an idea of what it was like to have heaven on earth, essentially. So he talks about all of these 9 things. And I'm not going to go through all of them, because there's a lot of them. But we're going to talk about a couple. So you and I probably both have ideas of what it means to be happy. Can any of you tell me what makes you happy? What makes you happy? Your little brother? How about your new baby brother? Does he make you happy? Baby Jake? Anybody else? The start of the weekend? I think a lot of parents could agree with that one. Anybody else? You guys are quiet this morning. I know what makes me happy. I'm a farmer, and what makes me happy are brand new babies. They're so cute. I wish they could stay that way. But anyway, so we have all different versions of what makes us happy. How about if you, like, have a day where they call school off? Yeah. So Jesus talks about 9 different things that he thought real happiness would come from when he did the Sermon on the Mount. He called it being blessed. Being blessed is like getting a special scoop of happiness that comes directly from God. And I'll tell you the truth. Some of Jesus' ideas about what it means to be blessed are pretty hard to understand. And those are the 9 Beatitudes. So we're just going to talk about a couple. One of them is, blessed are the merciful. Has anybody heard that word before? No? Have you? That's pretty good. Merciful means that we're being kind and generous. So being merciful means helping other people that might be in need. Can anybody tell me how you might be merciful?
An A.
Maybe it'll help somebody learn the alphabet?
Yeah.
Can anybody else tell me something where you're blessed or you could bless someone else? How about someone else? Anybody?
Me.
No? All right. Well, I love it when people are merciful to me and help me out when I have something that's hard going on. If I can call on someone when I'm having a bad day and they'll listen. Or when you're at school and maybe you're sitting at the lunch table by yourself and someone comes over and sits by you. That's a blessing, right? So Jesus had a special reason that we are blessed or happy. If we are merciful, he said that if we are merciful to other people, he will be merciful to us. So he will bless us. Another one is, blessed are the peacemakers. So a truly happy person is a peacemaker. Does anybody know what it means to be a peacemaker? What do you think? Anybody know what it means to be a peacemaker? Any ideas? No? Okay, sometimes one of the people that you are hanging out with, maybe they start an argument. It's sometimes how we handle that argument. Do we get mad and angry and start a fight with them? Or do we maybe want to just talk to them and figure out a way to solve it? So that's one way to show peace, is to, instead of starting an argument or continuing to make the argument worse, or maybe your brother or sister, you're fighting with them and you kind of get physical a little bit, instead of doing that, take a deep breath and sit down and talk to them about it, right? So when we're mad, we need to choose to be happy and to help others and be the peacemaker. And Jesus said that if we're a peacemaker, we will be called God's own children. That's pretty special. So these things that Jesus said about true happiness, they're actually about the kingdom of heaven. So he's actually talking about what God is really like. He's merciful. He's a peacemaker, and he brings us true happiness. So that way we can understand what it means to be in the kingdom of heaven. All right, you guys want to pray with me? We'll do a repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for teaching us about happiness. It looks different than what we see in the world. But we know that it shows us the kingdom of heaven. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, I have a little treat here.
Listen to what the Lord says. Stand up, plead my case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say. Hear, you mountains, the Lord's accusation. Listen, you everlasting foundations of the earth, for the Lord has a case against his people. He is lodging in charge against Israel. My people, what have I done to you? How have I burdened you? Answer me. I brought you up out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you, also Aaron and Miriam. My people, remember what Balak, king of Moab, plotted, and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered. Remember your journey from Shittim to Gilgal, what that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I become before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord please with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is God and what does the Lord require of you? Just act justly and love to love mercy and walk humbly with your God.
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 31. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards, not many were influential, not many were of noble birth, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord.
The Holy Gospel is from Matthew, the 5th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. And he said, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for there is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. The gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Let's take a moment to pray. Heavenly Father, we gather together to worship you, to set aside all the things that we have going on in our lives, the busyness and the questions, the things that trouble us, things that sometimes we don't want to even share, but we can come to you. And we can be in your presence and we can be let these things be known and shared. We're grateful, Lord, for this word today and for the gospel that comes to us as a word of hope and promise. Bless us, Lord, as we hear it. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's take a little poll this morning. How many of you receive email from the church? Raise your hand if you would. That's great. How many of you read your email from the church? Oh, well, look at that. That's wonderful. Well, sometimes I will send an email off to all of you. And if you get all the way down to the bottom, if you actually read to the end, there will be my signature or put my name and the like. And I usually sign off by saying blessings. Blessings with an exclamation mark. Blessings. I do like exclamation marks. I put them all over. Other times I may sign off more officially and say, in Christ's love, or the peace of the Lord be with you, or something similar. But most often I will say blessings. Well, I've noticed a couple times, too, that people will say something when you leave the store or you're in a restaurant and they're done waiting on you. And they'll say, have a blessed day. Anyone ever had anybody say that to you? Yeah, have a blessed day. One waitress I'm thinking of says, have a blessed day, honey. And I'm pretty sure it's not just me. I suppose another example would be when someone sneezes or coughs right in front of you. And they kind of get their hand over their mouth or their elbow. And you say, bless you. Bless you for spraying me with all those germs. Thank you very much. I was in a store recently, and there was a checkout counter and a cash register and a credit card machine and all of that. And next to it was a wicker basket, a little wicker basket. And it was filled with polished rocks. Each rock had a phrase on it or a word. And the one I noticed right on the top was one that said, count your blessings. A rock with a word on it that's a reminder to us to count our blessings. Well, let me just do one more survey here. How many of you will bless somebody during the week? A lot of you? So you're blessing givers then. You'll say that in a particular way. Well, today I just want to ponder just a little bit about what this means. What do we mean when we bless someone or speak of blessings? If we count our blessings, these are usually things that we are thankful for. If we count our blessings, we will say, well, we're blessed with a family. We're blessed with a beautiful home. We're blessed with food on our table. We're blessed with good health, with friends, meaningful work. These are blessings that we can count. Often when we bless someone, we are offering our hope or our desire that the person we are addressing will have all of these things, these blessings, that their day will go well, a blessed day. We could easily substitute to that, good luck. Good luck. Sometimes that can have the same meaning as blessing. I know I say bless you often when someone is about to go in for surgery or to the hospital or they're waiting for test results because because I want them to be blessed. I want God to bless them so that everything will go well, that their surgery will go well, that their treatment or the cure will restore them to health, that they won't suffer with any pain. I want God to bless them. And so I say, well, bless you when you go through that. But is this blessing that Jesus gives us today in Matthew's gospel, blessed are you, Jesus says, does it simply mean a sentimental good day or good luck? What does this blessing that Jesus talks about today really mean? When Jesus says, blessed are you who are poor in spirit, blessed are you who mourn, blessed are you who are meek, who are hungry or thirsty, who are merciful, who are pure in heart, who are peacemakers, and who are persecuted. Does this blessing that Jesus is talking about sound like how we use the word blessing? I suspect it's really quite different. When Jesus went up on the mountainside to teach, you should note this, the first verse, the very first verse, there's three things that we want to lift up. I'll read the verse for you. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach. You remember what was going on before this? If you were here last week, you may have caught some of that. But Jesus was beginning his ministry and he was going about the countryside and he was preaching. He was saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He was preaching to people. He was also teaching them, and then he was healing them, and great crowds began to follow. Then we get to chapter 5 in Matthew's gospel, and now he gathers his disciples. So what was Jesus doing? Well, the answer is easy. He was teaching. He was not preaching. He was not calling people to repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand, nor proclaiming, nor healing people. He was teaching them. Well, who was he teaching? Well, that's an easy answer, too. It was the disciples. And although we might assume the crowds were there, maybe within earshot, he really was speaking directly to his followers, his disciples. Now, the crowds might have been there, but we don't know. The phrase that says, and he sat down with them, right? He sat down with the disciples is a pretty good indication that the crowds weren't there in the same way. Because if you were standing up, the crowds could see what was going on. But here it's more intimate with his disciples. And why would the disciples need to know this? Because those who follow Jesus, his disciples, and you and I, need to know why. Why are we blessed by God, regardless of our circumstances? In fact, a life is not necessarily a life where everything goes right. Well, that's an overstatement, isn't it? We are all sometimes in lives that are challenging, where the pieces don't fall into place, where we don't feel very blessed. We must be blessed. God's favor is upon us if everything goes right. But what about when it does not? We all know that life isn't always roses. Why? Because of sin. Our sin, the brokenness of our world, the sin that is all around us. Sin has consequences in our lives and in our world. Yet Jesus says, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. How is this a blessing? Well, it's not, as you and I often use the phrase, but fortunately for us, it is exactly how God intended it. The blessing that Jesus speaks of here turns the world upside down. It is the opposite of what we think. We think that blessing is to have much. But Jesus turns it around and says it's to have little. It is to be humbled. Paul writes in Romans, he says, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's what the kingdom of God is about. Truly I say to you, in John 5, Jesus says, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. This is something that comes to us not because we have done something to earn blessing, but rather it is something that God does for us in Christ so we are blessed. Jesus died on the cross that our sins might be forgiven and we have eternal life, so that God did this for us out of love. We didn't earn it. We didn't do anything. So we humble ourselves. We bow our knee before the Lord and we listen. And when we are in that moment where we're ready to give up everything for him and follow him, Jesus says, you are blessed. You are blessed because of these things. Well, as followers of Jesus, as disciples, we now see the world differently. Blessing comes to mean something much deeper. We give up the way of the world and think so because of these blessings that we know Jesus brings to us, the kingdom of heaven. Some of you may know that you're up on having the most current app on your phone, right? Y'all have a phone? Because y'all got that look, what is with you all? This is like went into a southern drawl of some kind. Yeah, so you got a phone, you know what an app is. Someone nod your head so I know you're with me. Yeah, okay, good. Good. There's an app, it's called, or a software called Grammarly, and it corrects your grammar. And who of us does not enjoy having our grammar corrected, right? I think of seventh grade, right? Mrs. Clark, she was a great teacher, but she was a grammarian, if that's an occupation. She hammered into us good grammar, or tried to, I should say. And when I say hammer, I do mean hammer. Some of you are very good at grammar. Marla over here, and Cindy, Norm, we send the annual report to them, all the reports, and they get to correct everything, and they send it back. And it's all marked up with red. And it's, so who needs the app? Yeah. But surprisingly enough, grammar is actually important. It's not like algebra where you're never going to need it again in your life. Let's take a look at the text just quickly here. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Is. Present tense. Right now. It's happened. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. It is now that the kingdom of heaven. It is not a promise into the future that you have, but it is something you have right now. As one who is poor in spirit, one who has given up everything, one that the world has beaten down, one that you have been through trial and tribulation, in that you have the kingdom of God now. Blessed are those then who mourn. And look at this, for they will be comforted. Future tense. It is theologians have this great, it is both and. It is both right now and into the future. It is a promise that Jesus has made that because of his death and resurrection, we have the hope of eternal life that will be in the future, and we will receive our comfort there because of that. So blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek, for they will, it's all future tense here, will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. You see, it is always looking to what will become and how God will use our times of grief, our times of sorrow, our times of brokenness, and use those in us, because the future then, tomorrow, the future is what God will create in us, a blessing. That we can trust. Because in verse 10 then, he says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Friends, we have the kingdom of heaven right now. We have it because of what Christ has done for us, and there is no better promise than that. And it will be a blessing if we walk and hold that in faith. And all God's people agreed and said, amen. Let's stand. We're going to sing the best song you've ever heard. Let's confess together our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He descended into heaven. Seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. I'd like to share some good thoughts this morning, some things that we are thankful for, some things that we may want to lift up in prayer. And so, is there someone who would like to share that? Looking, and Sam, I need some help. You got the mic, buddy.
Let me get the camera.
So, you'd like to share?
I got you.
Okay. Hi, the little four-year-old girl that I talked about last week, she went through surgery. She was home the next day, and the tumor was benign. It was actually like a cyst, and they said that it was probably there from birth. So everything is good. We went and saw her yesterday, and she was just normal as could be.
That's awesome. Yay, God.
Anybody else coming in? Oh, back there, Ruth.
So yesterday we had our mission service work day,
And we worked from 9 until 3. And we had 19 volunteers. And over the course of the entire day, from 9 to 3, we put in 99.75 hours of volunteer effort. We accomplished great things. And if you were there, would you please stand? Because I would like to give some credit to those who really worked hard. Maggie Grayshoes made a phenomenal noon lunch for us. So we were well fed, we had great communication, good times, shared names, and I encourage you in the future to come. So nobody's going to stand with me except Edie.
Yeah.
Karen Horniman.
Kathy.
Jan Carlson, Sharon, Kathy. Yes, Taylor was a big help. I don't know, fingers are probably, she tied, please blame this, for 6 hours. But anyway, thank you very, very much.
Yes, good morning. Just a quick yay God for choir members. Even though we have people who wisely in this weather go to Alabama, Texas, Florida, and different warmer parts, I have such a great group, and I thank Pastor Mark for filling in every now and then. We encourage you to join. It's not too late. But also, real quickly, I watched out the window as church was just beginning, and I saw people running into the church on this cold day, and I'm so grateful to be part of a church that people run to. You know what I was saying? Chris.
Mine is more of an announcement. Sorry about that. I should have done it earlier. Right after service, we do have, thanks for the Sunday school kids, and I just need some youth helpers if you can come find me so I can use your help, that's all.
Super, thank you. All right, well thank you for your yay gods this morning. I know there are more amongst you all, so please share those with others and freshen your time of fellowship. Let's continue with our worship and we receive our offering. Thank you for your gifts.
No.
us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, we want to lift before you this day the need for comfort and for healing in the lives of our church family. We lift before you Renata and Robert and Chris, Glenn and Jill and Mary, Karen and Tom and Haley and Cindy and Nyla. Lord, in your mercy. And for those family and friends that we have, for John and for Diane, for Pat and for Gary, for Betty Jo and Carrie, for Brian, Albert, and Susie, for Terry and Chris and Kay, Jonathan, Bertha, and for Bobby, and for Phyllis and Kate, for Sarah and Charlotte. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, too, we pray this day for all those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. Lord, especially we want to lift before you the family and friends of Jerry Dressel and of Brad Lynn. We pray, Lord, that you surround them with your loving care, that you remind them once again of the hope and promise they have in Jesus our Lord, the promise of a resurrection to come and life eternal with you. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, for our community too, for LCMC and for Augustana District Churches, and especially now we pray for Christus Lutheran Church in Clintonville, Wisconsin, and for Conrad Lutheran Parish in Pondera Valley, Conrad, Montana. We ask, Lord, that you bless those churches and that you keep them safe and continue to inspire them with your Spirit and move them forward. Lord, in your mercy. And for our mission work with Oni and for Pastor Elmer in Cuba, for our friends at Love, Inc. And, Lord, we want to pray, too, for all of those who serve in the military, for our law enforcement and first responders, for our firefighters and frontline workers, and all of our area churches. Continue to bless them and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength.
Compares to the promise.
want to be sure that you know you're invited to go get a treat and then come right back in here so we can begin our annual meeting, and bless you as you be a part of that. So go in peace and serve the Lord. We will. Say it like you...